Hello and welcome to the Federation University Road Nats Review Show. Macka, we might rename the program Trading Places. You're at home or at your mum's place in Ballarat and I'm at the Western Hotel. Today I win.
You do win. And I tell you what, well done, because you made the quick journey out of the studio in Melbourne up to Ballarat. You also got a stake in. I don't know how you did that, Matthew Keenan, but that is, you are a professional, you are organised, and you do not miss a beat. So well done. You win today. But I must say, I'm pretty happy with my backdrop this evening, and I'm pretty happy with what we saw today, Matty. Brilliant three races, in fact, in the junior under 19 women first up in the morning, junior under 19 men, and then, of course, in the under 23 men. Absolutely sensational.
Yeah, well, as you mentioned, I was in Burwood doing the commentary for the under 23 men's road race, so I missed seeing the actual action for the under 19s. But just looking at the result sheet, it looked like great races with small groups coming to the finish line. But the under 23 men, I see this as our research day, a crystal ball into the future. And it was a super aggressive race, as is so often the case. There was a lot to like.
Yeah, there was a lot to like. And you know what? All three races are research day nowadays, because 10, 15 years ago, under 19s were considered pups. They still are to you and I. But in actual fact, there's a few riders that are only a few years away from potentially turning professional. It's, the sport has done full cycle. We're seeing 21, 22-year-olds win the Tour de France. So look, it really is, the sport is healthy in that age bracket, and it's certainly healthy in the under 23s. There was so much to love about today. Let's take a look at the highlights package, shall we, and look at what unfolded.
Day two of the Federation University Road National Championships saw the future stars of Australian cycling take to the roads of Mount Buninyong for the road titles. First up, it was the under 19 women, which saw three riders come to the finish to dispute who would be crowned the Australian champion. In the dash to the line, it was Felicity Wilson-Heffenden who got the victory, the rider from Hobart taking the win ahead of Mackenzie Coupland. In the under 19 men, there were two riders that came down to the finish in Buninyong to see who would get the gold medal. And it was Josh Cranage who got the victory, the rider from South Australia, getting the better of Cohen Jessen. The under 23 race rounded out the day, 140 kilometres around Mount Buninyong. And it was an aggressive race right from the very start. There was a breakaway group of 11 that at one point got out to an advantage of more than 3.5 minutes. In that group, James Panezza, Alex Bogner and Liam Johnson looked dangerous, and they certainly looked to be the strongest. With three laps to go, they still appeared to be in contention to take the win. But on the penultimate lap up Mount Buninyong, it was Alistair McKellar from Israel Cycling Academy who launched out of the peloton, quickly closing a gap of 1 minute and 55 seconds. And as soon as he got there, there was no waiting around. He immediately went on the attack. But they were back together in a group of some 7 or 8 riders as they hit the bell. But then they made the left-hand turn onto the Midland Highway and across to Mount Buninyong, and McKellar flew. He rode away solo, the others racing for the silver medal. Alistair McKellar taking the victory, the biggest win of his career, joining a distinguished honour roll that includes greats of Australian cycling such as Simon Gerrans, Simon Clark, Rowan Dennis and Caleb Ewan. This is just the beginning for McKellar.
To be able to do it by yourself and be able to enjoy it at last, yeah, as you said, 200-300 metres, oh, it felt unreal. I've been dreaming of that for years, and to finally be able to do it, so surreal. I've raced this course for a couple of years now. I know I got a bit worried when the break got out to 3+ minutes there, but I knew it's always the last 1-2 laps that win this race in the past, and I knew the legs were good. So I just kept telling myself I needed patience, had the legs two to go, and yeah, I'm surprised I did it.
In the battle for the minor placings, it was Brady Gilmore who won the sprint for the silver medal. Alex Bogner, who was one of the great aggressors throughout the race, finished in third place, picking up the bronze medal. What a huge win, Macka, and I wonder if it has sunk in now. Let's introduce him, the new Australian under 23 road champion. Welcome to the Western Hotel. It is Alistair McKellar. How does it feel now with a little bit of time to reflect on it, Al, that you are the Australian champion? We've got a little audio problem. Can't
you might be on
Al.
Mute, Alistair.
Haven't quite got him yet. Macka, we'll get that sorted out and we'll come back to him in a moment. It's a big moment in his career. As he spoke to you in that interview, he's been coming here for a long time. He was close in the under-19s.
had a few years that he'd rather forget in the under-23s, but this is a huge step forward.
It is a massive step forward, Matty. And, you know, I know you called it and you watch it live, but and you also know what it's like when you're there on the ground watching it. And when we saw them come through the finish line, and, you know, it was really touch and go. And in, as he said in the interview, there was a period when it went out to 3+ minutes. He got a bit nervous. And I reckon he had a right to get a bit nervous. But he was the only guy from the peloton, or what was left of it, to go across to the remnants of that breakaway, which was 6 riders. He was the only guy to do it. He did it at the right time. It was all in the timing. He kept his composure. Here he is now. Have we got you back, Alistair?
Yeah, sorry, got you.
That's awesome. All right.
Well, there was a lot that could have gone wrong in the race today, and you smoothed that all out. So we're allowed to have a couple of technical issues when it comes to a post-race interview. Macka was just talking about the fact that the gap was out to nearly 3.5 minutes. Was there any point in the race where you thought this one might have slipped through my fingers?
Yeah, I was quite stressed there for a while. I reckon 6 to 4 laps to go around that time, I was like really stressing that the race could have been out of our hands by that time. And all the major teams were represented. A lot of them were happy, so there was no one really in the bunch to, you know, bring that back at all. But yeah, I knew with a bit of experience now doing that course a couple of times that you really just have to wait last minute. And luckily it played out in my favour.
All right, hang on, Macka. So I'm not done with the time gaps yet. 2 laps to go, 1:55. That must have still had you a little nervous.
Yeah, no, definitely. It had me real nervous. But I knew there's nothing you can do at that point. It's 2 minutes, 2 laps. There was only one thing to do, and that was to go as hard as I could. And yeah, lucky I had the legs.
Do you learn a lot from that, Alistair? Like, you know, I guess you had to wait. You sort of didn't have the choice. You had to wait till the last minute. On reflection, and probably in a few months, in 6 months or a year's time, will you look back and think, gee, I learned a lot from that, and I've matured a lot from just keeping composed, waiting for the last minute, and then you get a bit more confidence, you know, in future races?
Yeah, no, 100%. Especially with this course, I found, you know, I've done it twice as an under 19 and twice as under 23 now. Well, now 3 times. But just knowing from the past that you really have to leave at last minute, and even watching other races, you know, the elite race, the last couple of years, you really see it's one, you know, two or even 1 laps to go, or even the last 50 meters. The artist knew the legs were good, and I just had to be as patient as I could, and 2 to go was my target and my goal, and that's when I was going to go, and I stuck to that, and yeah, luckily it paid off.
You mentioned the past. There was a moment in that final lap where the ARA car came up alongside you and they said, you've got this. Sure, you're riding the Israel colours now, but how important has that team been in your development?
Oh, tremendously. Without them, I wouldn't even be able to be in the position I am today. They kind of took me under their wing when I was younger. I was only under 19 when I joined that, or even under 17, sorry, when I joined that team. And just getting the development and guidance growing up, yeah, honestly, wouldn't be where I am today without them. All the guys there have made a massive impact on my career so far. And yeah, I have all of them to thank for that.
And so I said to you today, Al, I think that was the last question. You know, you're wearing the Israel Academy colours, but it'll be splashed with green and gold. Has it sunk in, you know, a few hours later now, that feeling that you get to wear that jersey now for the next 12 months? It's not many riders get to do that anywhere in the world, national champions, but you'll be one of those.
Yeah, no, it actually still hasn't sunk in. Still sinking in a bit. Lots of love and messages have been coming through, so that's nice, but yeah, I think it won't hit me for a couple of days, or even once I pull on that Israel jersey with the green and gold, that'll feel pretty special. Yeah.
It is just the beginning of a big year. What's next for you in 2023?
Yeah, well, starting with the time trial on Tuesday, I'll hang around for that. And then I'm straight off to Europe the following day for a training camp, and then straight into another season. I've already done 2 seasons with Israel Premier Tech, and I've got another one coming up on their development team. And they've been great. You get lots of opportunities racing up with the pro team and just learn so much from that. Racing in and out with the development and the world tour. You get exposed to a lot and learn a lot of it the hard way, and still learning a lot and lots more to learn. But All of that, the experience gained the last 2 years would have helped a lot today.
Go on, Macca.
No, I was just going to ask, Al, you talk about what you've learned from and how good they've been to you, Israel. Who are your mentors? Who are the people that you sort of look to for advice? You know, is Simon Clark, do you know Simon well? Have you spoken to him? And what sort of other people do you sort of have around you that give you support and give you some mentorship along the journey?
Yeah, I haven't raced with Clark yet or even met him. He was one of the few guys in the team I probably wouldn't have raced with, but going to those pro races and, you know, some of the big names like Sepp and Mark, Paddy Bevan, they're all great guys, treat me as equal, and I've learned heaps from them. There'd be plenty more I could name off. A lot of big names in Israel. And yeah, when I get the chance to race with them, you're just absorbing so much, both in the race and when you're at the dinner table or whenever in the room. It's pretty surreal when you get to a race and the guys I've watched growing up are just sitting across the dinner table with me and, you know, racing in the same colours.
So what if we're sitting across the dinner table in 12 months and I ask you, how was 2023? What do you reflect on? What do you hope you can tell me?
Yeah, off to a great start. That was the first big goal. I'd love another European win. I got my first one 2 years ago now, and another one would be great. But the biggest goal is just to turn pro. Up with Israel would be awesome, but wherever, that's my biggest goal. If I can sit opposite you at the dinner table in 12 months and say that, then I've had a good year.
Well, we hope it happens. Right. And we hope it happens at the Western Hotel. We've got one last question, a really easy one before you go. Two answers. Who wins the women's race tomorrow? Who wins the men's race? Really easy question.
Yeah. Tricky. Women's. I'd like to give an outside bet, but I know she's going well. I'd love to say Anya Lau. We'd love to see her get up, especially now she's signed for a big European team, and she's been racing well and did the Tour de Women's Tour de France. So it'd be awesome to see her. And for the men's, I think you can't look past someone like Bling. The course is built for him. I think if he's come back for it, he means business. So I reckon he'd be a safe bet.
All right, if either of those get up, we're going to replay this little snippet of you predicting them. If they don't win, this lands in the bin and nobody ever sees it again.
I was going to say, if you're right, I'll be messaging you throughout the year, mate, to get some tips of the classics, the tour, everything.
Congratulations today. Good luck for the rest of the season. We hope you do get that pro contract by the end of the year.
All right. Thanks, guys. Really appreciate it.
Alistair McKellar, the Australian Under-23 Road Champion. After this, Macca and I, we're going to try and dissect and work out who is going to win the road races tomorrow.
Don't just do life, smash life. Wrangle it, get up real close, and see what makes life tick. Lasso life. Shape it. Step back and squint at it a little. Yep, that'll work. Nurture life. Steer life. Start from the start or somewhere in the middle. With industry connections and real employment opportunities, don't just do life. Hack life. At Federation University and TAFE.
At Mortgage Choice, you're never alone. You're the smart ones who refinance to take the pressure off. You're the ones expecting to find your first home. Or you're the ones screaming out for the quiet life. From applying to buying and beyond, your local Mortgage Choice broker will be right there with you. And they'll never treat you like just another loan. Mortgage Choice. You're never alone.
Okay, Macca, it's time for us to put our reputations on the line. Alistair did it. I like in the women's race that he picked Anya Lau, as she was with ARA as well, just like Alistair was. So there might be a good omen in that. Let's take a look at the women's race first. You know the course really well. 104 kilometres for the women's race. There's no easy spots on this course.
Matty, there is no easy spots. And look, we've said it when Federation University came on as a naming rights partner, and they added that extra 2-3 kilometres through the university itself. There it is there. As you look at the graphic, it's just gone through. That has been a game changer on this circuit, I believe. Of course, we've got the Mount Bunny on climb. Look at the profile. Once, twice is fine. I did 3 laps this afternoon in the Grand Fondo. That was like, that hurt enough. But 10 laps for the women, it is a tough climb. And look, the other big element, Maddie, is the weather. It's going up another 5 degrees tomorrow. It's going to be 33. Probably won't be 33 when the women are racing. They start at 9:20 in the morning, so it won't be 33 degrees then. But it's still going to be quite warm. I'm sitting outside now. It's still very mild outside. So the temperature is going to be a lot warmer than what it was first thing this morning. That will play an element, a role towards the end of the race.
Yeah, for sure. I do think it'll be a bigger issue in the men's race than the women's race, but it'll heat up the final few laps. Let's take a look at a few of the favourites. I like Alistair's tip with Anya. She'd have to win from a breakaway, and a breakaway has succeeded in the past. If everybody was racing as an individual and there were no teams, Grace Brown is the name that jumps off the page for me.
Yeah, she does. She does. I see Grace, and we all see her because she's proven it. She's a real classics one-day specialist, isn't she? Apart from being a fantastic time trialist, I do question whether or not woman against woman, 10 times up Mount Buninyong, she'll have those climbing legs against some of maybe some sort of more fancied climbers. The likes of Amanda Spratt. Where's Spratty at? Where is Spratty at over the distance like that right now? She raced the Bay Crits, but has she got the form that can get her around in that gold medal position? She's done it before, twice. You know, Matilda Reynolds, Peter Mullins. There's a number of riders. What's so good about it, Maddie, is it's a really great field.
Yeah, I think Spratty is the one to beat. She's aiming for number four. She's already won three, Macca. She's aiming for four. Oh, no, she's greedy. She just keeps winning. She looked in the Bay Crits the best I've seen her in almost 2 years, because she's had a horrible injury to overcome. She's back in business. New team, new lease of life. She's got Brody Chapman and Loretta Hansen as teammates. I think she's my number one pick. A little bit of sentimental picking that from me, but I think she's going to be tough to beat. Jayco have got such strong numbers. We saw that in the crit. And I think for them, Ruby Roseman Gannon, she was fourth here last year. She can get around. She can survive the climbs. She's going to be tough. Smokey, Justine Barrow from Rock Salt Live SRAM. The last time Spratty won, Justine Barrow was second. And I thought Justine was maybe even slightly stronger than Spratty on the climb. Yeah. And we've seen how smart Rock Salt is with Peter Mullins calling the shots for them on the road.
Yeah, and you and I both, you know, sing praises of Peter Mullins, just how she rides and how she will call the shots. I do like Alex Manley for Jayco, I will say that. She had an amazing season last year, coming off the back of a pretty successful track campaign. She switched back to the road. Let's not forget, she did race the road previously, but there was a big focus on the track with the Olympics. She won a number of races in Europe. She rode the Tour de France, and she really did herself proud there. So I think Alex can get around this circuit tomorrow. Look, the big unknown, though, for all of us, we can all say our tips, it's January. You never know quite where the form is for a lot of these riders, and they don't tell you too much either leading into it. So it's a little bit of a guessing game.
Alyssa Politis is another one. She medaled last year straight out of the under-19s. Mm. She's a favourite for the under-23s. She's part of the Jayco team. She could find herself having to work for others and not get that opportunity, but they've got so many options. I'm looking forward to seeing how Danny DeFrancesco goes. She won the NRS last year. She's riding for the ZAF racing team in Italy this year. She's got Lizzie Stannard as a teammate. DeFrancesco is another smoky, just like Justine Barrett.
Yeah, she is. And again, look, I know it's only a criterion, but based off the Bay Crits, what we saw, she looked really well. And so did Lizzie Stannard, actually. They were both riding really strongly there. Look, it gets better and better every year, the women's field, and the depth gets better, and that's what we love about it.
All right. So that starts at 9:20. It's 104 kilometres. It'll finish just after midday. We've got the coverage live on SBS. The coverage doesn't kick off right at the start. We're on air at 10:30. It's going to be a fantastic race. And I'm going to stick my neck out and I'm going to go with Amanda Spratt. Now, let's get to the men's. Okay, pick one name, Macca. Go on, one name.
Yeah, it's. Well, I'll go with Alex Manley. Okay. I'll stick with Alex Manley. She'll have the numbers. She'll have the legs. She'll get the job. And she's got a pretty good finish on her too.
Pretty good. She's one of the fastest sprinters in the world. She's awesome. Okay, on to the men's. Luke Platt, defending champion, no teammates. Can he go back-to-back?
No, I don't think so. I think rarely has it been done in the elites. Look, he was super strong at the Bay Crits, and it's not discrediting him at all. I'm just merely going off statistics that he'll probably possibly be marked out of it. So, no, I don't think he can.
Okay, Ben O'Connor, riding for AG2R, doesn't have any teammates either, but he has been fourth in the Tour de France and he's won a stage there. And he is keen for this one. He did the Poppers ride in Western Australia. So if you can do that ride, you can ride a world title.
That is the world championship of Western Australia, absolutely. Ben O'Connor can win this. And yes, he will have a target on his back because of who he is. But he's such an aggressor. We've seen him at the highest possible level, Matty. He races on the front foot all the time. He's not scared. He's not shy to sit back and wait. I think he can get the job done. Will he win it? I don't know. There's so many. You can throw a blanket over 30 or 40 riders tomorrow that can win this race.
All right. One of the sentimental favourites, Simon Clark. He was targeting this race last year, but he didn't have a contract and he got the call up to the Israel Premier Tech team. He was good at the Bay Crits. He did 150Ks each morning, then did the 1 hour crit in the afternoon. I thought he looked pretty sharp and he's smart.
Simon Clark can and possibly will win this race tomorrow. Yeah, he is.
We agree.
He is brilliant. We saw what he did, that stage win in the Tour de France across the Roubaix cobbles. I watched him 10 years ago finish top 10 in the world in Florence on a rain-soaked road for 250 kilometres. Simon Clark will ride through a brick wall if he has to tomorrow. And you know what? He's probably
He might have to ride through a brick wall. Okay, Caleb Ewan, can he get around?
You know what? He's been a little bit under the weather, Caleb. He's been fighting a bit of a stomach bug. I'm not sure. I think that could make the difference in the really warm weather. I hope he's recovered, but I'm just not sure he will be 100% for a
healthy.
Because this is a tough course. It's not, you can't roll around and hide in the bunch at all on this race. You have to have some legs.
Yeah, if he's not 100% healthy, if anybody's not 100% healthy on this course.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah. So we might see Harry Sweeney, his teammate in the breakaway, or Jared Drisness. All right, just a few more before we get then to the Jayco team. James Whelan, riding the colours of the bike shop, bike gallery from Camberwell. He doesn't have a contract, but gee, he looks good, and he medalled last year.
I'd love to see him win. I'd really love to see him win. He's a real gentleman. James Will, and he's a lovely guy. And, you know, I always want to see, I wouldn't say he's the underdog because he's been in the world tour. He has every right to grab that jersey tomorrow. But as you're saying, he is without a contract and this could be the difference for him. So I'd really love to see him win.
I've got a few more to rattle off for you. Jay Vine. Big yes.
100% he can win. I put him on the same pecking order as Ben O'Connor, if you like.
Chris Hamilton, Jay Vine,
his future's just getting started, isn't it, really?
Oh, yeah.
He's already done a fair amount in the last 12, 18 months, but he is just getting going. Jay Vine can win tomorrow.
He's a massive yes for me. The Hurricane, Chris Hamilton.
Yeah, Chris is, look, he still seems, he's been around a long time, but he's still reasonably young, isn't he, Chris? But what he's got is a ton of experience. I think he'll be motivated, Matty. I imagine he's been sort of targeting this as a, you know, an early season goal. He needs everything to go perfect for him tomorrow, Chris Hamilton. But if it does, yeah, he's in with a sniff.
Okay. One more smoky before we get to the Jayco team. Now, this guy, here's his team car. Driving the car, Brett Lancaster, Olympic gold medalist, Giro d'Italia prologue winner, former teammate of yours, sports director for the last few years at Ineos. Calling the shots in the passenger seat, Mitch Docker is his sports director. Trecky Johnson doesn't have any teammates. He's out there on his own, but by God, he's got a strong car behind him.
Yeah, and 2 years ago, I think it was possibly the most exciting race we've ever seen. Cameron Meyer won in the end. Trecky Johnson was up the road early, and he was away for a bunch of laps. He probably went too early. I think he would have learnt his lesson from that. It wasn't a bad move that he made that day, but riders just cook on Mount Buninyong, and that was a hot day as well. If he can sit back, be composure, and he will slide under the radar. He's good. Riders will respect him, but he will slide under the radar compared to the names that you've just reeled off.
Yeah.
You cannot discount him, and surprises have happened here at Buninyong before.
Okay, now the team with the big favourites. We've heard it from Alistair already, the under-23 champion. Bling, Michael Matthews. I think with such a strong Jayco team around him, he's not going to come here if he's not informed to win. I think he's the guy to beat tomorrow.
I don't think he is. I don't think
okay.
he is.
Go.
Yeah.
Tell me why.
Yeah. I think Jayco will ride on the front foot, as they have done in the past when they've got numbers here. They won't ride to set tempo. They'll ride on the front foot. But Michael, I don't think will do that. I think he'll sit back and wait and wait and wait. I think if anyone's going to win from that team, it'll be one of his other teammates, like Cal O'Brien, like Luke Durbridge, who's done it here before. And because of the stature of Michael Matthews, that's part of the reason. I think he'll have a target on his back, and I think he could be marked out of it.
Yeah, and that team, they've also got Lucas Hamilton, Chris Harper can win this thing solo. They've got so many cards to play. Durbridge has won before. That's enough of the predictions from us. Let's have a listen to some predictions from you.
Well, let's go to men's first, and I really like Chris Harper for Team Alula, Jayco, and if they race for Michael Matthews, could be quite the wet appetite, because I reckon it could be a head-to-head showdown between he and Caleb. So in the under-23s, really happy with Mia Hayden's form at the moment, but certainly Lily Pollock could make the early break as well. So tomorrow for the Elite Women's Road Race, I'm going to go a bit outside the box and say Georgie Howe.
Women's race, I'm going to say Brody Chapman to win, of course. Men's race, I can't really see past Luke Platt.
I'm hoping it's pretty aggressive. I've got some plans to obviously put some riders in an EB, and got Justine there as a final card at the end. And I think if I had to pick someone who's not from our team, I think Alex Manley is the in-form rider to beat.
Well, after seeing Kel O'Brien's ride yesterday, I think you've got to put him right up the pointy end. Chris Harper, Luke Platt, those guys, you know, the usual suspects, mate. They come out to play in January. They want to win, so it wouldn't surprise me if they're up there. I'm not going to pick them up.
Alex Manley was looking pretty strong in the crit, and she didn't touch her nose in the front. So, yeah, that would be my prediction.
Oh, Mackie, you found a few people to agree with you. Did you organise that?
Not at all.
Oh, hey, rubbish.
Everyone knows she's good. Everyone knows she's good, Maddie. Come on.
Okay, all right. Well, the coverage kicks off at 10:30. We've got the women's race. Then you and Gracie have got a one-hour show between the women's race and the men's race. And then we're live for the back end of the men's race. Macker, I can't wait. I love this day.
It is. It's a monster day. It's Super Sunday, as we've been calling it for a number of years now. And it is one of our favourite days on the Australian cycling calendar. Look forward to it.
We'll see you all tomorrow on the Couch Peloton. You can add your comments in the discussion in the comments here. Who do you think is going to win both the women's and the men's? We'll see you tomorrow at 10:30. Bye from the Western Hotel.